What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In a previous video, we tackled the differences between both arrays and linked lists. But creating an array is native to any programming language, because what it does is allocate sections within the memory, and all you have to do is specify a type. Open close a pair of square brackets, and boom, your array is ready to use. However, for a linked list, it isn't as easy as this. Each language provides its own definition and implementation of the linked list. Then we developers use these predefined classes while programming. Therefore, in this video, we are going to cover one way to implement the linked list data structure, so you may take a look at what's really happening in the back end of all these abstract data types. Let's first start by creating the interface of our linked list class and call it list, just like in the Java API. The linked list we are creating will most probably be used to store any type of objects, so let's go ahead and make it generic. If you are not familiar with generics, do not worry, we already have a video covering all about them and linked in the description below. This interface will tell us what are the functionalities provided by our linked list class. So, a user should at least be able to insert an item to the list, remove an item from the list, and traverse this list, or in other terms, print out the items present inside the list. Finally, an additional perk, let's add the ability to check if our list is empty or not. Now, if you watched our previous linked list video, you already know that the linked lists do not store our data directly, but instead, the data is wrapped inside a node, which stores our data and points or references to the next node in the linked list. So, the next thing we need to create is the node itself, and this node should contain 1. Our data, and 2. A reference to the next node in the list. All that is left to do is add getters and setters, if we want to keep the access of the fields private, which is the way to go, of course, and add a toString method to print out the data in our mode later on while traversing the list. To do this, I am going to use Lombok annotations. And of course, if you are not familiar with Lombok, there is a video for that here on Geekific. Our node class is now complete. Let's jump to the main class of our video, which is the linked list itself. As we previously mentioned, in order to access the whole list, all we need is the root node only. So let's add a node object as a field in our linked list class and name it root. I'll also add the size as integer, so it is easier to keep track of the number of elements inside our list. Now, let's implement the list interface and with it all its functionalities. First, the insert method. This insert method takes the raw data as argument. So, the first thing we have to do is wrap it inside a node. Then, the new node we are inserting should become the new root of the list. And to do that, its next node reference should point to the old root. In code, what we do is set the next node of the newly created node to be the root, and then update the root variable to be the newly created node. And finally, we have to increment the size to keep track of the added elements, and that's it. We are now able to insert items in the linked list. Removing an item, on the other hand, isn't as straightforward as this. Two cases should be taken into consideration. The first case being if the item we are removing is the root node itself, and the second case if the element we are removing is any other node from within the list. If the item we want to remove is the root node, all we have to do is set the next node of the current root to be the new root node of our linked list. The old root will no longer be accessible and is now considered to be deleted. However, if the node we want to delete is not the root node, we have to loop over the nodes in the list until we find the element to delete. But our loop should start from the next node of the root, because remember, we just checked that the root isn't the item we want to delete. And in addition to this, we need to keep track of the previous node for each node we visit. And this previous node starts at the root, because, well, the node preceding the next node of the root is the root. But why do we have to keep track of each previous node? Because when we find the item we want to delete, the next node reference of the node preceding it should be updated to reference the next node of the item we are deleting. If we don't do that, we will not only be deleting the node we are trying to delete, but also all the nodes that come after it. Practically, in code, because we made sure that the root is not null, we can go ahead and assign it to a previous node variable, and start iterating from its next node, which is the current node variable in our case. And while this node is not null, which means we haven't yet reached the end of the linked list, we have to check if the data stored inside the node is equal to the one we want to delete. If that is the case, we update the references as we just mentioned and break out of the while loop. If not, we update the node variable used in the while condition of the current node in this code snippet to be the previous node, and the new current node will be the next node in the list. This will allow us to iterate over all the nodes inside the linked list. Finally, same as the insert, we have to decrease the size of the list. We just removed an item from it. Okay, now I know that most of you come from different backgrounds and have different interests and are probably watching this video for different reasons. So I am also going to cover the recursive way of implementing the remove operation for those of you who love recursion. I don't expect all of you to instantly get what is happening here, but I assure you it is 100% equivalent to what we just wrote a few seconds ago. I will dedicate a video in the future explaining how recursive methods work and how to come up with and write them. But for now, I'm going to go through it quickly because recursion is not the main topic of this video, but linked lists are. So instead of writing all this bunch of code, what we can do instead is call a new method. Let's also call it remove, like an overloaded version of the initial one, and make it take the data we want to delete, the previous node, and the current node as arguments. In the first call we make from the actual remove method, we will pass the root as the previous node and its next node as the current node, just like we initialized them a few seconds ago. Then, inside the recursive method, as long as we haven't reached the end of the list, we keep on looking for the element to delete. When we find it, we update the references and break out of the recursion with a return statement. If not, we call the recursive method again. Notice that the breaking condition we use to return from the recursive call is exactly the same one we used to break out of our while loop. Now that this is out of the way, let's continue our implementation of the list interface. The next method overridden here is the traverse method. Well, by now you might have guessed how we implement this one. So first, we have to check if the list is empty. If this is the case, then there are no items to traverse, and we have to let the user of the application know that. In this example, we are just performing a print to the console of the sentence list is empty. However, if indeed our list does contain some elements, then we have to traverse it. And to do so, we have to iterate over the items in the list one by one by starting at the root node, as always, because that's all we have. This is very similar to what we did for the remove operation, except we don't need to keep track of the previous node. For every item we traverse inside our loop, we can apply the action we like. In our case, it will simply be printing the node's data to the console. Okay, so as we did for the remove method, we are going to also implement the traverse operation using recursion. And it starts by removing this bunch of code and calling a new method instead. We can also call it traverse. However, this one will take a node object as a parameter, and the first time it is called, we will pass to it the root node. Inside this new method, and for each node provided, we will print out its data to the console and then call its name method again. But before doing this, we will have to add our breaking condition, the same one we added in our while loop a minute ago. This condition checks with every recursive call if we have reached the end of the list. The last and easiest method left is the isEmpty method. We already used this method a couple of times during our implementation to check whether our list was empty or not, but now it is time we actually implement it. Remember the size field we created at the beginning, incremented while inserting and decreased while removing an item from the list? Well, if the size of our list is zero, it means that the list is empty, as easy and straightforward as this. Now that our linked list class is complete, let's go ahead and see how it looks in action. To do this, I went ahead and created a main method where we are going to test our code. In there, I created an instance of the linked list class we just created and inserted a bunch of elements inside it. Then I printed out this list by traversing it. So the output we should see is all the elements of the list, which are the numbers 10, 20, 30, and 40, 40 being the root node of the list as it was the last item to be inserted. Then I deleted the number 20 from the list and traversed or printed it out again. As a result, we should see on the console the numbers 40, 30, and 10 without the 20, as it was removed from the list, if the remove operation works as expected, of course. And finally, the isEmpty operation should result in a false because, well, the list is not empty, as you can see. If you try to run this piece of code, you will see that the output is as expected and that our linked list works perfectly well. We first got all the elements we inserted in the list, then the number 20 was removed from this list as it should, and at the end, the Boolean false indicates that our list is not empty. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.